Welcome back to Indianomics. We are now discussing the second plan put forth by REC and PFC on how to save some of the stressed power companies. I have with me Mr. PV Ramesh, the chairman and managing director of REC. Mr. Ramesh, thank you very much for joining us. We know that your Parivartan plan has picked up some 16 power plants and you want to transfer them at net book value to an SPV. But my question to you is, if these plants are viable, why not sell them at market value through the ARC-AMC process, which the Mehta Committee is recommending?
Thank you very much for having me. Let me try to explain. Let's understand the context, and I'm sure this is known to everyone, but let me give him a moment. Now, we have almost about 60,000 megawatts of power plants that are stranded under construction. Now, of which about 20,000 are completely stranded, so there's no option, there's no retrieval process, there's no viable resolution for them other than to go through an IBC process.
Okay.
Now, about 20,000 megawatts of them have some visible commercial value. These are either commissioned or very, very close to commissioning. These are projects which have either PPAs, FSAs, partial, full, or with a suboptimal performance. And you have a third set, which are about 20,000 megawatts again, and I'm talking here about the coal thermal power projects. These have no PPAs, no FSAs. So there is no visible commercial viability for these projects. And these are projects which are good projects, they are functional, they are very close to commissioning. Now, so there's a huge gap between their true economic value and their commercial value. Now, let me stretch the context a little further. Now, why are these assets, why are they without a PPA? Now, the fundamental reason is that the demand pickup has not been commensurate with the generation. Now, look at the situation 10 years ago, our total installed generation capacity was 120 gigawatts.
Yes.
Today it is 344 gigawatts. Mm. So there's been an exponential growth over the past decade in generation. Mm. The similar investment had not been made in the transmission segment and the distribution segment in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you look at the current context in the last 3 to 4 years, almost a lakh of crore investment is being made in the transmission segment. And under Deendayal Upadhyaya Gram Jyoti Yojana, the Saubhagya, the Integrated Power Development Scheme, the put together, another lakh of crores of grant is being provided by government in terms of strengthening the distribution infrastructure, modernizing the distribution grid. So there's been a whole dissonance between the demand supply. Now, this is a unique context. Now, the power sector, you would agree, stands on a different footing for the simple reason that there are a number of factors which are completely external to financial institution or to the promoters. Now, what the RBI framework provides for is a financial resolution, but not an asset resolution. Now, let us consider a situation as the CEA is making a projection, as the demand picks up at a much faster pace. Today, it's growing at 5 to 6%, and it's likely to go to double digits in the next couple of years. And because of the investment, just 40 million households being connected, all villages electrified, all grids modernized. Now, this is likely to have an exponential growth in terms of demand.
Mm.
And for the sake of future energy security of this country, we need to protect these assets. Otherwise, what would happen? And as right before our eyes, these assets are deteriorating.
Mm.
There would be no viability for them. There's no market for them.
Mm.
Who are the buyers in the market? Number one, for these assets.
Yeah.
Number two is, what is the commercial viability? So what's happening? They're likely to go for liquidation, which essentially means that when we most need the power and when the citizens need the power, we wouldn't be able to provide that power. So necessarily somebody has to take ownership and manage them during the period of transition as we move from a transition phase of now we have a situation of high supply, moderate demand. We are going to move to a high supply, high demand paradigm. Now this transition has to be managed.
So
is in that context that we are proposing this.
Okay, who manages the plants?
Yeah, right.
And you will need money even at that time. You know, running fuel charges, working capital charges will be needed.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. I mean, now let me put this up front very clearly. Now, there would be an arm's length, but the governance structure would be, or at least what we have proposed is that this would be owned jointly by those principal stakeholders who have about 80 to 90% of the exposure to the power sector, which is the two power financing companies, REC, PFC, and some of the major banks. You know, both private sector and the public sector. They together form the form this AMRC. This would be managed by through a professional agency.
We're
saying that there could be an opportunity for the private sector or for National Infrastructure Investment Fund to really take that critical control management stake, and then it is managed professionally. We have proposed an investment committee which would be peopled by professionals, so that the financial institutions are kept at an arm's length. The O&M would be done by through a bidding process. It could be NTPC, it could be any of the power managers. So, and the working capital would be provided by the financial institutions that have a stake, as is various required. The power can be, we could use our leverage with the DISCOMs to negotiate short-term PPAs or sell it in the power, in the power exchange. We have requested the government to support through policy drivers in terms of coal supplies. So, I mean, this requires a confluence of a number of interventions, which are policy interventions, operational interventions, financial interventions, given the nature of the sector.
All right. Well, you have laid out the plan, sir.
This, I mean, we have taken, I mean, I just want to, Lataji, I just also want to make it very clear. This is not, we are not trying here, we are not speaking about the REC assets here.
Yes.
Our exposure, as you know, is primarily in the state sector where there is no stress. So we are not, this is not an REC motivated initiative. This is initiated by us taking a global picture of the power sector and the future horizon in the next 5 years.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Ramesh, for joining us and explaining the Parivartan plan. Well, the key takeaways here are that for the Sunil Mehta plan, the problem is it is going to take a long time to set up the ARC, and the inter-creditor agreement also need not necessarily mean that banks will be able to take decisions. They could be taken by the unsecured creditors to the NCLT. The problem with the Parivartan plan is that, in the first place, the Reserve Bank may not allow to transfer assets at net book value, because that will mean merely kicking the can ahead. And two, it requires a buy-in from several parties, from the Reserve Bank, from the Government of India, and from all the financial institutions. At the moment, that looks like an extremely challenging order. So it does look like the NPA problem at the moment does not have very concrete solutions. That's it on this edition of Indianomics. We'll be right back.